If you don't want people to think you're stupid, don't act like it. If you don't want people to think you're racist, don't act like it. Don't say things that go that way. Joe, you got to at least know that people are going to look at that. And even if you had some truth to what you're saying, how you said it, because you chose the analogy, everything that you said is now disqualified. And so now am I no longer looking at what you said about Christian nationalism. I now look at you as not a Christian. I now look at you as a racist white man who only wants to advocate for white folks, white Anglo-Saxon. Because this is going to take us where I want to go to. I think that, and the reason why I asked, do you think America was just a nation that had a Christian wrapper around it? I think America was founded on Christian principles. Now, for some, I think there were some people that were absolutely godly. I think there were some that were not, and there were some that were kind of just hiding in between. Because whether it be individual people or the nation, there were still ungodly atrocities that the country would do. There were those who would say that they were against slaves, but go ahead and accept it and have slaves, and then would molest or do things to their slaves. There were those who would do all sorts of atrocities to Native Americans, to Indians, and let's be honest, to each other. The reason is it's not the Christian foundation. It's the demonic inside man's heart. And I think ultimately what ends up happening is it ends up being something that shows up as kind of, I don't know, what's the word? Racially biased in some cases. And I think everybody to some degree has been, can be, will be. And I think that's what happens if you start determining, again, we're going to have this Christian nation and who's going to be the Christians in charge. And so that I think I could be wrong. And this is where I want you to help me and even defend this point or defend yourself. Because I think if you're going to have an idea, I think the best thing that you have to have is good PR. Make sure that you don't have to apologize for anything. Because there, to be honest, Joe, there's some things that you said, like, wait a second, huh? I fix that. The issue about America and, well, we weren't as bad because we didn't go out and take slaves, but we bought slaves. And so let me ask you about this comment.
And so the comment that I made is, I said, well, you know, the founders, right, our civil fathers in America, it's not as though they were hopping on ships and sailing across the Atlantic and going into the bush of Africa with, you know, human-sized nets and casting them on people and kidnapping them, dragging them back onto their ships and then taking them over and exploiting them as slaves. No, we didn't go over and steal people. We went over and bought people. If we're going to condemn America, right, if we're going to rewrite history, 1619 Project, you know, and really America, you know, wasn't built on principles of freedom. It was built on the backs of slaves and all that. Okay, if we're going to do that, I just think we need to be consistent. I just think we need to be fair. I don't think we should do that. But if you're going to do that, then you've got to hate. You got to hate. If you hate, I mean, AOC, Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez, she hates America. Liberals hate America. They're not patriots. They didn't even want you to fly an American flag on the 4th of July. They hate America. And all I'm saying is you need to be consistent. And if you hate, and they do, hate America, you got to hate African nations. That's my point. Because Americans went over there and bought people. And we can argue till we're blue in the face about all the things that are wrong about that. And I probably agree with you 9 out of 10 of your points. But if that's wrong, and I believe it is, but if that's wrong, then how do you defend tribe warring against tribe and the victors then enslaving the losers, and then selling them?
Okay, so this is where I would say, when I saw that, Joel, I'm like, okay, you have to fix that. Can you explain that? Because these are just some of the clips that are just out there. And in all fairness, I think it's just best to give you an opportunity to say, okay, this is what I meant, this is what I'm trying to say. The clip didn't fully encapsulate what I was trying to say. So can you explain that?
Same thing with the 19th Amendment. Happy to explain. First, I just, you know, for clarity, so I understand what I'm explaining. Could you help me and telling me what you see wrong with that?
Well, here's the biggest issue, the biggest rub against Christian nationalists. You all come off as either racist or race-ish, or
Okay.
Maybe you too in favor of white heritage, or maybe claiming to have a more superior heritage. And in doing so, sometimes you either uplift yours and say, well, what about them? Kind of thing. And that's what I see happening here. We're not that bad, but because we didn't go and take them, we just bought them. Oh, by the way, Western Europeans did go in and actually also went into Africa and also took slaves as well. So it's not just European nations buying slaves from African tribes. They also went into some places and also took slaves themselves. And so I'm trying to find the rationale for that particular argument. It's almost like you're trying to make an excuse where none should be made. And I think that can be the problem. You rub folks the wrong way when you say, well, it wasn't that bad. Here's the truth and so forth. No, it was bad. Let's just call it bad and then move on.
Yeah. So my point in that clip was not to say that that no American throughout the course of our history bears any moral culpability or guilt for slavery. That's not what I was saying. I was trying to combat the 1619 Project, people like Alexander Ocasio-Cortez and certain people in the Democrat Party and all that kind of stuff, that their argument is not that, hey, you know what, the whole world at various times and in various degrees has been guilty of slavery. The Ottoman Empire, Asians are guilty of slavery, Africans are guilty of slavery, Europeans, Americans, everybody's, mm-hmm. virtually every nation in the world has had slaves. My point was to say, I don't know about you, Corey, but at least from what I've witnessed over the last 10, 15 years of political, cultural, you know, discourse and in media, virtually every movie that's made that's woke, you know, and all these kinds of things, I don't hear people saying, hey, you know what, America's guilty. And that matters as we seek to be righteous before God. But at the end of the day, you know, America's no more guilty than this nation and this nation and this nation, you know, and the whole world is guilty. So let's repent and love our brothers in Christ, regardless of their skin pigment, regardless of their nationality, and let's move forward. That's not the message I'm hearing. The message I'm hearing is not that America's guilty, but that America is uniquely guilty. It's the most guilty. The argument that I've been hearing for the last 10, 15 years with this BLM, wokeness, DEI disease, is that America is uniquely guilty. That and basically the argument would, it basically amounts to this. They would say, well, the reason why America is so prosperous is because, it's not despite, it's not because of obedience to Christ and the ways that although imperfect, and the ways that, yes, they failed, but their attempt to be obedient to Christ, to honor Christ from their founding, God bless that despite sins with slavery. Instead, it's the opposite. The argument that I've been hearing for 10, 15 years, and even in the church, the woke church, is that America is prosperous not because of righteousness despite slavery, but that America is prosperous because of exploitation precisely because of slavery. And so the argument that I was making in that clip was simply trying to debunk that myth. I don't believe that America has been so blessed, temporally blessed and temporally prosperous and powerful, a superpower on the world stage, not so much anymore, but for a long time, for a while, and all these things, and you know, the growing GDP and all, you know, and it's because, you know, because we built our wealth on the backs of slavery. I don't think that's it. If that was the case, then there would be certain African nations that that absolutely were completely entangled in slave trade and for centuries that would be uniquely prosperous. I think that you got to do better than that. You got to account for the blessing of God on America and not just call it exploitation. So all that being said, there's nothing that I was trying to communicate that said, hey, you know what, the African slave trade, right, the transatlantic slave trade, it's not so bad, you know, it's, you know, this was great. The guys that I admire when I think of, you know, the Confederacy and some of the Southern guys, and there's some guys, you know, in the Union with the North as well that I would also admire. But when I think of guys like Stonewall Jackson, you know, or Robert E. Lee, you know, and good Christian men, these were Christian men. They loved the Lord. They really did. And I think there's a higher likelihood of seeing some of these guys, much to some people's chagrin, you know, seeing these guys in heaven for eternity and worshiping, you know, worshiping the Lord side by side with Stonewall Jackson. I think if I was a betting man, not saying that I am, but if I was a betting man, God alone sees the heart, man looks at the outward appearance. I'm not making a definitive claim, I don't know. But if I was a betting man, I would bet on Stonewall Jackson being in heaven above Martin Luther King Jr.
Well,
just saying.
Here's what I would say, because sometimes I would say this, Joe. Sometimes it seems as you're trying to go the inflammatory route, which is fine. If it's true. Now, I have no idea where Stonewall Jackson is or any of these other people. I have no idea, because one of the clips that we always play is that you can be saved and stupid. So somebody can be saved and make stupid decisions or be off.
That's true.
But I wouldn't. But I think the problem is when you highlight people. I think the argument could be this. Now, I call myself Captain America. I love America. I never quit, and I want to kill the bad guys. But I also have to honor and explain and make it understood that we've done bad. We're all bad. I think the point you ought to make is, yes, we were just as egregious, just like all of mankind is egregious. And the difference between what happens here in America versus Africa, or compared to Muslim nations that took in more slaves, right, is our at least trying to be rooted in the Bible.
Right.
We weren't always that case. But I wouldn't go back and then crap on Africa, like these African nations, this or that or what have you, because everybody was selling in trade slavery. At the time, you had white slaves. You had, so.
Right.
So, and then to say that nobody.
But that's my point, is I would not argue, and I guess this might be where you and I just disagree, and that's okay. I could be wrong. But I would not argue that we were just as egregious. That's my whole point, is I think part of the reason why America historically has been so uniquely blessed by God is it because we were not just as egregious. And that doesn't mean, again, that
how,
doesn't
how
mean,
are we not as egregious?
As Muslim countries?
Yeah, how are we not as egregious?
Because Muslim countries worship demons. Their slavery was far more severe, far more widespread, numerically far greater, because Muslims worship demons.
Okay.
It's,
but to the slave, does egregious. It matter if your slaveholder, if your slave master is worshiping demons or worshiping Jesus? I think it's worse that if you say, if you tell me that you've got the true God, you worship you say you worship the true God, and you inflict these atrocities on me, I think that's far worse than someone who's worshiping Moloch or Baal. At least they got it out. They don't know any better. We should know better.
Right. Hypocrisy. So you, it sounds like your main principle, and I would agree with, hypocrisy is egregious. That is one example of an egregious sin. I'm with you. Hypocrisy is egregious. However, the reason why I do think it matters, because, you know, the scenario you just painted was, you know, the guy worshiping Allah, who's a slaveholder, and the guy worshiping the triune God, who's a slaveholder. The reason why it matters is that in some cases, the guy who is worshiping the triune God isn't actually worship. It's just a name only. He's not actually regenerate. He's not born again. And so it's not just that he is a slaveholder, as a slaveholder, he is abusing his slaves. He is doing certain things that the Bible strictly forbids. He's sinning. He is sinning against God. He's sinning against his slaves. He's sinning against his country. And while claiming the name of being a follower of Jesus, and so in that sense, it's all the atrocities of the Muslim slaveholder plus the degree of hypocrisy, you know, while lying. And so in that case, sure, I'm with you. That's egregious, and an argument can be made that it's more egregious. That's not what I'm talking about. That did exist. Nobody's denying that. I have no doubt that there were unregenerate slaveholders who were abusive to their slaves. That's documented. I have no intention to argue against that. I think that's stupid. It's not stupid, but my point is stupid to argue against it. So I'm with you. What I'm talking about, though, is guys like Jonathan Edwards, who I really believe, by all the documentation that we have, and again, you and I don't have a time machine, and we're not omniscient, we don't see the heart, but I believe Jonathan Edwards was a good Christian man. I really do. And he had slaves, or George Whitefield, you know, he had, I believe that these were good Christian men, and that they treated their slaves as much as it depended upon them with dignity. They invited their slaves into fellowship as brothers in Christ in the church. They catechized them. They even taught their slaves to read in many cases so that they could read the Bible for themselves. They knelt down side by side on the Lord's Day at the Lord's table to take communion. Robert E. Lee did these things. And I think, yes, I think there's a dynamic difference between Robert E. Lee and the Muslim warlord. Is that a crazy position?
Well, again, I hold them more accountable. Now, I have said I've said this, that is it possible that a person could have owned slaves and gone to heaven? Well, sure, we've got people in the Bible that have done so. So, but the difference is what you know, how ignorant you are. For example, if you treat the person, and it also depends on what type of slavery you have. Right. But those slavers who would call themselves Christians, who would also drop off slaves at these places in different places in the Caribbean and intentionally dehumanize the slaves, cutting babies out of the women's womb and so forth, and raping the women in front of them. Well, no, you know what? No. And if you've passed that, then that is a point I've got to question what's on the inside.
I'm not giving up. No way. Not giving a pass to that at all. So I'm with you. It depends on, I agree with both things that you said. It depends on what kind of slavery are we talking about? And then, you know, how did you handle yourself as a slave owner? In what manner? One thing that, you know, as I'm trying to study history and get a good idea of, what was the world like and what was America like? And, you know, what was the cause of the Confederates? Was it just to defend slavery, you know, or was it the right of states to secede from what they viewed as a tyrant who was trying to centralize, you know, and federalize, you know, all the power and take it away from the states? And, you know, there's a lot of...
Well, why not just say this then, Joel?
History is complex.
Why not just say this? Rather than pointing a finger at Africa, because those nations... or those tribes, they're no longer in existence. Rather than lifting up the virtues of a Robert E. Lee or Stonewall Jackson, which you are never gonna win on that. Wisdom would say, you're never gonna win on that. And you don't have to. If they're in heaven, amen. If they're not, amen still. But why not just say this? Speak to how leaning or falling back on the virtues of the scriptures is the issue. Why not just say, and again, I'm Captain America, I love our country in spite of all of our ills, and slavery was abolished in 1808, or the slave trade was abolished in 1808, while other countries in the world kept it going, and it was abolished because of people who were believers of the Bible. Focus on that, because the reason is, if you focus on that, how slavery was eventually eradicated in Western civilization and how the slave trade was abolished, I think this is what goes back to my first point. If you focus on that, there's no need for a Christian nation. If you focus on that, the way that Paul advocated for Onesimus being set free, the way the abolitionists did, not in tearing down the country or whatever, but appealing to the heart of the people. If you say you love the Lord, well, then prove it. Here's how. And so I think that ought to be the case. The problem is, though, with all due respect, it comes across, though, Joel, when you say certain things like, and I've got to give you the benefit of doubt, but it comes across as though you have a preference towards whites and not towards blacks. And so
why?
On some of the things that you said, let me play two clips of something that you said, and another person that this guy says something, and I cannot believe that there wasn't a response for you. But let me do with the first two clips first.
Like, I walk around my neighborhood, and it's not that there are different shades of, you know, white and brown. Who cares? No, it's like full straight up Hindu garb at our neighborhood swimming pool that my daughter is asking, I'm trying to explain. She's like, you know, what, like, and I don't even know what country I'm in my own neighborhood. I don't know where I am. It's, you know, I mean, the number of, when we go on a family walk, the number of Pakistani, Hindu, all these different, not just ethnicities, but religions with visible religious outfits on. And, you know, the same thing, like when we go to Costco, I'm like, where am I? You know, and so like every, I mean, it's rare. Like, we'll go on a family walk and every now and then we'll pass by, you know, a white family that's a man and a woman and has more than one kid. And every time I see it, I'm like, I don't want to be this way. But I feel like this like small sense of relief. Like, I see you. I'm glad you're one of my neighbors. Because at the end of the day, again, it's not about whiteness. But at the end of the day, if things get rough, I don't know if my Hindu neighbor is going to fight to save the lives of my children. I don't know what vested interest. Like, I love this country. I'm willing to fight to defend it. A lot of people here, I don't think, are.
So you, I'll let you explain. The question is, why is that you feel this way about seeing a lot of people of different ethnicities that are not white in your in your neighborhood who, however they may be dressed, why would that give you pause? Why would you rather see a white couple together, maybe walking their dog or jogging?
This is a question. Same as the first two clips. I'll ask you this. What about that? I'm struggling. I'll just go for it. So to answer your question, why do I care? Because I'm a Christian first and foremost, and an American secondly. I think that we have an elite political and cultural class that absolutely hates American citizens, wants to kill us, wants us dead, wants no future for our posterity, and is importing the third world to America by the millions in order to destroy the country. So seeing entire towns like Springfield, Ohio, taken over, you've got 500,000 in Springfield, it's 20, but you've got 500 total, upwards of 500,000 Haitians, which is 5.9% of the total entire population of Haiti. And Haiti, it's not that they're black, that's not the point. Haiti, the chief religion of Haiti is voodoo. They literally worship demons. There's cannibalism. Right, it's not who cares about eating cats and dogs. I care a little bit. I don't think you should be taking people's pets and eating them. And if it's duck season, go duck hunting. That's fine, but that's different than taking ducks out of the public park pond. But the bigger problem is not the pets. It's not the cats and the dogs and the ducks. The bigger problem is that in Haiti they eat people. So importing the third world, particularly voodoo demon worshiping cannibals from the third world in mass, 5.9% of their entire population to America, designed intentionally because you want to utterly eradicate and drastically, significantly transform the populace and demographic of this country because you hate it and you want it to cease to exist, is a massive problem. And I do not apologize for saying so.
But when you say when you say the statement about seeing somebody white or seeing someone in Hindu garb because you don't think that they're going to fight for this country, mm-hmm. And then I think I had the clip. I wasn't going to just run a whole bunch of clips or whatever. But you kind of equated
the DEI doctor clip. You got that one probably.
I do have, which by the way was bad. I'm going to say, Joel, that was bad, Joel.
It wasn't. Okay, I don't apologize. We'll get to it. If you have time, I'd love to get to that one.
So what's the difference between seeing somebody white versus, let's say, seeing somebody black or somebody Hindu or somebody Asian?
Well, the Hindu, so that's that question is a little bit mixed because there's multiple factors going on. But if we could just start with, seeing somebody white who's wearing a baseball cap with his two kids, pushing a stroller and walking the dog, with his wife and doing, a walk in the neighborhood, versus seeing someone who's Hindu and is wearing mm-hmm. religious dress. The difference there is religion. That's the difference. And I don't know if the white family is Christian, and I certainly don't know if they're truly regenerate, as we've been talking about this whole discussion, if they're truly Christian. But there is something to be said for Christian culture. And I do think that that matters. Symbols matter. Culture matters. Pretense, even pretense, which can be a problem, at the same time, there is a benefit and a blessing to pretense. I think it was Chesterton who said that hypocrisy is hypocrisy is vice's tip of the hat to virtue, meaning that as bad as hypocrisy is, there actually is something worse. And what's worse than hypocrisy is coming to such a degenerate state as a nation and as a culture and society to where people don't even bother to take the time to perform hypocrisy anymore because there's nothing to gain by doing it. You don't even pretend to be virtuous. Vice no longer even tips the hat to virtue because there's no benefit in doing so. You're just blatantly, obviously, publicly wicked and evil. I think of the coronation with King Charles. There was a lot of backlash, and I get it. England is not, it's like England, a Christian nation, give me a break. What a joke, and I totally get it. And that's true. That is objectively true, that it is a joke at this point. And yet, at the same time, there is still something to be said for the pomp and circumstance, for the rituals, and even if they're false, for even, you know, in the United States, the fact that is Joe Biden a Christian? Well, you know, we don't see the heart, but at the same time, Jesus says we can know a tree by its fruit. If I had to guess, I'd say, no way that dude's a Christian. He isn't. No, I don't think he's a Christian. And yet there's still something to be said with 46 presidents now. Throughout the history of our nation, we have not had one president who did it, who did not at least profess to be a Christian. And I do not look forward to the day when Pandora's box is open. I remember when, you know, Vivek, you know, during the primaries, you know, you had Ron DeSantis and you had other guys, and I liked DeSantis. You know, I'm going to vote for Trump because he's our candidate. He's the best we got. I don't think he's righteous, but he's the best we got. It beats communism, you know, but I liked DeSantis. Vivek, I like his rhetoric. I even, my personal opinion, I think he could be Jim Psaki. Yeah, press secretary. I think he could do that well. Just, you know, just using his rhetoric and mopping the floor with liberals all day long. I'd love to see him in that role. You know, but I don't. I didn't want him as a president of the United States because even though I know he embodies a lot of Christian virtues more than Joe Biden or Nancy Pelosi, who both, you know, profess to be Christians, Catholic, you know, to be specific, Vivek. I know he went to a Christian school, Catholic school growing up, but he's Hindu. I don't want America Hindu to be Hindu.
Is it three million gods? Religion?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir. So I am not for white heritage. I'm for American heritage. And American heritage is not exclusively white. That's not our heritage.
But it
includes black people. It includes, there's a whole host of different ethnicities that are included in American heritage. But that's very different than taking Indian people and importing them by the millions in 2024. That's not heritage America. And it's not because of a shade of darkness on a scale of pigment. You, Corey, would be darker than a lot of Indian people. And I'm glad you're here. You're my brother in Christ, first and foremost. And you're my American brother as a citizen. You, as far as I know, are a part of Heritage America. You can probably trace your family lines here in America further back than I can. God bless it. I'm glad you're here. And if you were my neighbor and we're walking down the street, so replace the white family in that example, and it's Corey Minor and his family, there's my neighbor. Glad he's in my neighborhood. If things get rough and Antifa comes down the block, you know, in the middle, I'm glad that Corey's across the street because we're going to go, you know, we'll get the ARs and we'll go hand in hand and we'll try to, you know, stand our ground. The point's not about whiteness, but the point is about first and foremost, religion, Christianity, and then second, nationality, not ethnicity, but national citizenship.
I think you make my point, but you're not hearing it because okay. Leave the ethnicity of the people alone and go back to what I was always saying, because these people, these Hindus or whomever it is, that's a field for you to go plant a seed and attempt to harvest. Just say it that way versus leaving here's how it comes across. Here's how it comes across, Joel.
Okay.
There are too many Mexicans. There's too many Hindus. There's too many. This, there's too many that. There's not enough. And do I believe
that if... Can I say real quick, Corey?
Go ahead.
For the record, there are too many Mexicans. And what do I mean by that? I mean, not Hispanics, mm-hmm. not heritage Americans who immigrated from Mexico 150 years ago, who are more cowboy than a lot of white Texans are.
I mean, those who want to actually be Mexicans in America.
But I'm talking about people who literally have their citizenship in Mexico and have crossed the border illegally by the million. There are too many Mexicans.
Now, listen,
I think we should be allowed to say that. That's not racist.
So what I'm saying is, this is what I said earlier. Maybe one issue is your branding, your PR has got to be better, because the way it comes across, if it comes across the way you intended, you wouldn't have to come back and re-explain it in many cases. Not to the other side. There's something going to take you what you say left, no matter what.
Right. That's true.
And we said this before here, me as a black person, I don't want to see someone here with another nation's flag. This is America.
Amen. That's right.
I can't go to another country and proudly represent America there,
right.
I would end up dead. I get right. that. But it comes across as though you're looking at their skin color, because the person in Hindu garb might be a Christian wearing Hindu garb, someone who looks this way. And so what your concern ought to be, or maybe you didn't say it this way, is that it should not be the color of that person. I'm concerned with these people holding Christian values. What you seem to espouse was someone holding American values. Well, wait a second. I thought we were trying to get to a Christian nation. Not just
our
traditional American nation, because our American nation is fraught with all kinds of issues. We want folks whose hearts have been changed. So
It's both. It's Christian first, no doubt. So if mm-hmm. we're prioritizing, it's Christian first. It has to be Christian first. But it is American second. In other words, what I'm trying to say, so I'm post-millennial, you know that. So I really do believe, not just in the final return of Christ, his physical final return, but throughout the course of this gospel age in real human history before the culmination of all things, I really do believe, like a little bit of yeast working through the whole batch of dough, or mustard seed growing into an all earth encompassing tree, I really do believe that the knowledge of the glory of God will fill the whole earth as the waters cover the seas, that we will, that Christian nationalism isn't just, you know, a Christian America, but it'll be all nations being Christianized. And when that happens, I believe it'll happen. And even then, just for the record, that doesn't mean that a universal Christianity of the heart, meaning I don't believe that every single person will be regenerate, but I do believe all the Christians will be all the nations will be Christian, that the nations will flock to Mount Zion. They'll see the goodness of God's law word, those kinds of things. And I know we disagree, but just humor me for a moment. I do believe that. And when that happens, for me, it's a win and not an if, and I could be wrong, but that's, you know, you just got to tolerate my bad eschatology, you know, but in my eschatology, I believe that's going to happen. So it's a matter of when, not a matter of if. But when that happens, here's my point. Not all the nations will be the same. They'll all be Christian. So they'll be the same in that regard. They'll all be Christian and worshipers of the triune God, and have just laws on the books being legislated that come from the law word of God, the eternal, eternally binding moral law of God. But there will still be different cultural expressions. America will still be distinct from the Sudan, even if both are Christian. America will still be distinct. It'll be like, that's America, right? It's Christian, and there's cowboys and rodeos and apple pie. God bless America. You know, and that, so I do think that matters. That's what I'm trying to answer your question. I'm not trying to be facetious and silly. I'm trying to answer your question. Christian first and foremost, yes and amen. That's the first priority. But then there is something to be said for national identity beyond just the Christian religion. The Christian religion is first, but beyond that, there are cultural expressions from you know, all fine arts or certain artistic forms and certain cuisine and certain this and certain that that do have components that make up a nation, that where you could have two Christian nations and yet they're still distinct. The distinctions aren't just religious. And what I'm saying is I like America, and I think that America's founding matters. I think its heritage matters. Its history matters. So first and foremost, let's not import by the millions people who worship demons and false gods. Let's start there, please. Let's start there.
Secondly, I say we should import by the millions anybody.
Amen. I'm with you.
The problem is, though, Joel, is it just comes across as it's about my culture, the way I do things. Because let's be honest, culture in Texas is vastly different than, let's say, culture in Indiana, where I was born, or in Maine.
That's true.
Or if culture in Texas versus culture in somewhere in Montana or North Dakota, where someone grew up on a reservation. Now they're saying, wait a second, we got a whole nother issue. And so it comes across, and I would say, if you aren't racist, if you are, and I'm not saying you are, but if you are, or if you're not, and you don't want to have that appearance of it, because if what you're saying, now I don't agree with what you're saying is being right, but if what you're saying is right, you shred it apart by giving ammunition to what people see as you being prejudicial towards someone that's white, Anglo-Saxon, Protestant, and you shouldn't be there. An Anglo person is just as garbage as a black person or an Asian person, just as rotten from the inside out. And so what we're after are people that place their faith in place their faith in Christ and live for that. But I would just say we don't want all these folks coming in and leave it at that.
At the level,
versus all these Mexicans, or if I see a white person, because it just comes across as though folks who want to give you the benefit of the doubt, well, doggone it, Joel, you shouldn't have said it that way. You shouldn't have put it that way.
No, I know. I know. There's, and I've had people reach out to me. I mean, most I get death threats, you know. I have protesters across the street at my house, at my church. And when I say death threats, I'm not being hyperbolic. I get thousands of emails of, I hate you. That's not a death threat. You know, you're a bigot, you know, or I hope you go to hell. That's not a death threat. You know, but I get literal death threats and have to file them, you know, with the county police. And, so I, you know, it's not,
I always going to be those folks. I've got some death threats. I just told the guy that that did
and,
it.
And I know what you told him. Yeah. So
I'll be there to see you this afternoon if you don't retract that. So
there you go. But I hear what you're saying. You're talking about those who want to give me the benefit, and that's what I was getting to. I got caught up. But no, there are others who are like, no, I'm a Christian, and Joel, I even have benefited from your ministry, and I like what you're doing, and I thank God for you, and your ministry's been a blessing. I'm rooting for you, Joel. And I would love to see you not commit public suicide, you know, just shoot yourself in the foot by making these statements. Come on, Joel. Like, I know that's what you're saying. I appreciate that, brother. There are others who have said that. And I'm trying to be very calculated. I know it seems like just like this Freudian slip, like, oh, well, under, you know, he's wearing a mask underneath. He's, you know, he's a member of the Klan, you know, or he's a neo-Nazi, you know, and the mask is slipping, you know, his covers break. No, it's actually not just strong language or shooting from the hip or a Freudian slip, you know, where I'm revealing. It really is, believe it or not. Now, I could be stupid. I could be wrong. This decision that I've made, you know, very consciously could be a bad idea. That's perfectly possible, but it is calculated. And what I mean by that is I think that Christians, and especially white Christians, and I think it's fair to say it like this, have been played by the boogeyman of racism. And that doesn't mean that there's no such thing as racism at all, that there's no such thing as a sinful prejudice based on race alone that actually is counter to the scripture, that dishonors God. I'm not saying that, but I think there have been so many false charges, slanderous charges of made up racism, things that now we would say that's racist, when it's like, it's not. And so I am, part of what I'm trying to do is I am actively trying to, like the first, you know, goose in the flying V, you know, that breaks the resistance, that makes it a little bit easier, and pushing the ball down the court and saying, guys, I really do think that it's okay to say that immigration is out of control, and to acknowledge that there's just a numerical piece of that. Two, there's certainly the religious piece, you know, Christian versus non-Christian. But three, even among nations or individuals, let's take it at an individual level, individuals that are Christian, I think that preference can be given. I really do. And I don't think you have to apologize. I don't think this is racist. You can give preference to certain cultures that are more compatible with America's founding, with America's heritage, with America's customs and its culture and its history, and say, you know what, somebody immigrating from Ireland, you know, or England is more compatible than somebody who's immigrating from Haiti, even if that particular individual Haitian family was catechized by a Christian missionary who went over there 20 years ago, and they actually are believers in the Lord Jesus Christ. I'm sorry, Haiti is simply less compatible with these United States. And so right now—
What about immigrating from Ghana or Zimbabwe?
Well, it depends. It depends. I think Ghana and Zimbabwe are certainly more compatible than Haiti.
But what about more compatible than Ireland or the UK?
Zimbabwe.
This is the problem. This is the problem, Ghana? You're going to have so many Christians from Ghana and Zimbabwe, but if they're coming from the UK, what you did is you made, whether you see it or not, a comparison based on the way they look. Because if you think UK or Ireland, you're thinking somebody white from UK. But what about somebody,
Muslim from the UK. Go ahead.
But okay, so you got a white guy from Zimbabwe, I mean, from UK who wants to come in, and a black guy from Zimbabwe and his family wants to come in. Who are you giving preference to?
And let's say they're both Christian?
No, we don't know what they are because they didn't put on an application. Okay. There is no application that said they're both Christian.
So it's just a guy from a white guy from England and then a guy from Zimbabwe. Mm-hmm. Which one am I going to give preference to?
It seems like
I'd like to say neither because right now we need zero immigration for a while. Mm-hmm. But if I had to choose and I could only choose one, then yes, Corey, I would choose the guy from England.
Why?
I think because it's the culture and the history of England, because our nation came from England.
Wait a second. We've got 13 colonies, or we've got an entire nation that some came from Spain, some from Portugal.
That's right.
You know, so all, you know, England, we all didn't come from England. So 200 something years later, we're talking about someone that came from, because UK is not a Christian country.
But right.
The average black person that you'll see on the streets, irrespective of where they came from, the average black person that came that you might come in contact with is more likely to be we don't know their heart, but at least a professing Christian than the average white person you would see. So if we make the conclusion, it seems like you're making the conclusion that white guy, I've got more trust, more faith that he's going to be more like me. And let's just be honest. We all can do that if we're all in a group together, a 1,000 strangers. You might see me hanging out, the black guy over there. Now, me personally, I go talk to everybody. I go pick on and mess with everybody. But the white guy will find somebody white. A woman might find somebody woman, black or white. You know. So, but it seems as though you're telling us the preference should be to the white person because I assume that he's going to be more like me, and therefore more like a true American. And that's the problem.
I would reverse that just for the. I think he's going to be not. It's not about me. It's not. He's going to be more like me. I think he's going to be more like America, and therefore, because I'm American, more like me, because I'm a part of America.
Yeah, but see, the thing is, you're defining what it is to be American.
No, I don't have the right to define what's. I think I've just.
Well, then why have a Christian nation then?
I just have eyes in my head. I can look at American history. I can look at American culture. I can look, and you're right. There are distinct expressions throughout. It's a big country, and not just the number of people, but geographically. And certainly, America is unique, far more unique than many other countries, in the sense that from its inception that there were lots of different peoples that kind of grafted in, you know, the Irish when they came, Jews when they came because of slavery, you know, and certain African nations. So there's a lot of different, America's unique, but I think I think we can still say that America it's a people and a place. Mm-hmm. It's a people and a place. It's not just a set of propositions, and it's not just an economic zone, and it shouldn't be just a tax farm. There's a people. There's a people and a place. And it's worth loving, it's worth defending, and it's worth guarding from those who don't fit.
So let's do this. I want to turn up the heat just a little bit on you, and then eventually turn down the temperature in the end, all right? So I'm going to turn the heat up and then bring it down, bring it back to where I think we can all have some common ground. So I've got to go to the clip that we were alluding to earlier about the black doctor, and then one more clip, and then I'll kind of take it down a little bit. All right.
When we moved to Texas, I needed to get a new cardiologist. And so my wife, you know, she does a lot of this for me because before we had kids, she was an RN, and she knows a lot more than I do. And, you know, I let her read those books. She read some.
By the way, y'all, he's just joking about it. I was just letting her read those books. So don't take that part and go anywhere with it.
That's a medical book. Yeah. And so she's doing the research and looking at these things, and she shows me two doctors, both of this within the same practice, same company, hospital, and saying, you know, do you like one over the other? And one was a young white dude and one was a young black dude. And I said, I prefer the young white dude. And this is why. The reason why is not because I'm white, but because we currently live in a historical moment in the West, and particularly in these United States, where I know that both of these guys could be perfectly qualified. But I also know that if there's a chance that one of them was not qualified and was given a free pass, it'd be the black guy. I know that that young white guy, there's no way he got a free pass.
Okay, so that looks bad, Joe. I think that is bad. So
I don't think so, but go ahead.
Well, no, tell us why you don't think so.
DEI was not my idea, Corey. Mm-hmm. Wicked people, Marxist people, instituted DEI, and it set our country back in race relations by about 80 years. I put the blame squarely at the feet of the left, and I will not take responsibility. And what I said in that clip, none of that is racist. And if that is racist, then racism is a word completely depleted of all its meaning, all its power. And if that's what racism is, then I really don't care if people think I'm a racist.
Why do you think there's a question to the black heart surgeon, his qualifications versus the white guy's qualification?
Well, I'm speaking in group dynamics here, right? So we're talking about group dynamics. I'm not talking about each and every cardiologist. The point of the illustration was simply to say, if we're talking about two individuals that I don't know from Adam, right? They're both perfect strangers. The, mm-hmm. the white cardiologist is a perfect stranger. The black cardiologist is a perfect stranger. First, before making this deliberation, there are other variables that I would and did take into account, right? Like looking at their credentials and those kinds of things. How long have they been with their particular practice? And, those kinds of things. What I'm saying is, and Virgil Walker, I don't know if you're familiar with him. He's a part of G3. Mm-hmm. Teamed up with like Josh Bice and Scott Annual and those guys. I actually talked to him this morning, not about doing this with you, Corey, but we were just catching up, and I've always loved him. We've disagreed over Christian nationalism, also G3. Mm-hmm. It gave me some grief, you know, and to be fair, I gave him just as much, if not more, grief. And I've tried to go back and say, hey, brothers, I love you. I really don't want to divide over Christian nationalism. Right now, it's like the orcs are at the gate. We're far outnumbered. We've got communists and Marxists that are trying to destroy our entire fabric of life. We can't afford to keep fracturing again and again and again with Christian brothers. So anyway, so I love those guys, and Virgil especially. And Virgil, for anybody who's not familiar with it, he's black. And so, which shouldn't matter, but it does in this day and age, sadly, because C point A, DEI set us back 80 years in race relations. But Virgil was funny when I started going viral for that clip. And by the way, this is worth mentioning. I am not going back, and you know this, Corey, but for your listeners, I'm not going back and watching my old content and clipping it up myself and saying, "Woo, that was a banger. I love that part of my episode, and I'm going to put that 12-second clip out there. You know, I think the people are really going to love it. This is going to really help my career." That's not what's happening. I'm getting clipped out, and really, let's be frank, because I think you'll agree with this. We'll start with some commonality here. Part of the reason I'm getting clipped so much right now is not just because I have these extreme views, which they are viewed as extreme by most people today. I don't think they are, of course, you know, but I'm biased. It's me. But the timing matters. Right now it's an election year, and Donald Trump, who hasn't even, if we believe him, and I don't believe him about everything, but I believe him on this, he didn't even read Project 2025. Project 2025 was a boogeyman, you know, an albatross to hang around Trump's neck as this, you know, this crazy, you know, extremist, far right, you know, extremist policy and legislation. And if Trump gets into office, you know, he's gonna be a tyrant, an authoritarian, you know, and blah, 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 fascist. You know, he's Adolf Hitler reincarnated, and he's gonna destroy the nation. It's gonna be a handmaid's tale. And so why is Joel Webbin continuing to go viral? Because I'm a self-proclaimed Christian nationalist. I helped a team of guys. Dusty Devers was one of them. William Wolf, Jeff Wright, you know, a number of guys craft this statement a year and a half ago. It's been a long time. But a year and a half ago, called The Statement on Christian Nationalism of the Gospel. And then you've got certain guys who are part of MAGA, like, you know, Marjorie Taylor Greene, who also have called themselves Christian nationalists. They've used that moniker, and they're easy to attach to Trump. And so then what happens? Leftist organizations like Right Wing Watch that has 600,000 something followers on Twitter. They comb through all of my interviews and all of my episodes. They take what they think is the most hardcore, you know, 12 seconds that they can find without mm-hmm. the rest of the context. And why are they doing it? Because they've got an election to win, because they actually want to win. Unlike, you know, conservatives, we're often beautiful losers and shoot ourselves in the foot. So they go and take Joel Webbin, and the message that they're trying to communicate is very simple, very clear. It's if you vote for Trump, you're going to get Joel Webbin, which I always say, man, if Donald J. Trump had half the spine that my enemies think he did, whew, that'd be an answer to prayer. I wish Donald J. Trump was half as conservative as our enemies think he is. Donald J. Trump is a liberal Democrat from the 1990s in New York. Donald Trump is Bill Clinton, essentially. He's not that conservative. I wish he was. He's not. So anyways, that's why this keeps happening. It's not me saying that's a banger, I'm going to retweet myself and blah, blah, blah. That's not what's happening. But all that being said, back to the clip, why, you know, if I have to choose, because we have to choose, right? I'm not going to have two cardiologists. Everybody's making a choice. Everybody's mm-hmm. making a choice. You're choosing this guy, choosing that guy. There are other variables that are more important than the pigment of somebody's skin.
Yeah, but you brought that up.
I did bring that up. That's right. So there's other variables that I would look to first. That's what I'm saying. The other mm-hmm. variables that I would look to first. But what I'm saying in this hypothetical scenario, and for me, this was actually a real scenario, but what I'm saying is that once you have dotted all the I's and crossed all the T's and you've gone through those other variables, which are more important, if all things are equal, as far as you can tell, and you don't know these guys personally, you can't shake their hands and ask them, you know, what, you know, that blah, 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 and you're going to make a choice, then I'm saying statistically, are there plenty of Black cardiologists who are incredibly credentialed and incredibly qualified and at the objective level, even a better cardiologist than 90% of the white guys? I'm sure there are. But I don't know. And so back to Virgil Walker, what I'm saying about, he had a tweet, you know, a while back where he was in a plane. He took a picture of the cockpit with the pilots. And he said, my two favorite colors to see in the cockpit, white and gray. They're old. White men, gray hair, white skin. And this is Virgil Walker. And he's being silly, but he's also saying something that's true because of DEI and how that's affect Boeing. I mean, this is documented, you know, doors flying off of airplanes because of meeting DEI quotas. Now, does that mean that no Black man is capable of flying an aircraft? Of course not. That's stupid. Nobody's saying that. I'm not saying that. Virgil's not saying that. But we're saying this is the world we live in. It's not a world that I came up with. This was not my decision. This isn't what I wanted. And I even said it in the clip. I was like, I wish this wasn't the case. I didn't want this world. But a bunch of Marxists, like bona fide Marxists, Kamala Harris, her dad is a Marxist professor, a bunch of Marxists, they created a world that pitted race against race and that created through affirmative action, through DEI standards and quotas and all these kinds of things, where we now, when we see a minority holding a certain position, it is now human nature, and not human nature in the total depravity sense, but I'm saying reasonable. It is reasonable, and statistically, it's true that we now have to ask ourselves at some level of suspicion, did this guy really earn the job with merit, or is this a DEI hire? That's sad. So, I wish it wasn't the case.
So now you've got a reason to assume the Black guy isn't as qualified. Now, in the issue such as a cardiologist, I don't think you can have a DEI cardiologist because that hospital.
You can with admissions to school. You can with the grades on SATs, mm-hmm. You can with the GPA for those schools. So let's say
the kid gets in school, okay. And let's say he did or did not deserve to get there, didn't earn it. Mm-hmm. What we do know he did was pass the requisite exams, and also his intern and so forth, his residency. I said intern, residency and so forth, because what's going to govern this person, or what's going to determine if we should use this person's, one, his track record, his history, his resume, but then two, he can't work at that hospital if he can't be insured. So if people are dying because of what he's doing, his insurance is that you can't write the guy because folks are dying on the table. And so now, if we're talking about somebody that
people said the same thing about American Airlines, to go back to flights, for just they said the same thing about American Air. Like, surely American Airlines would just, as capitalists, right? You didn't have to be righteous; you could be just, you could be greedy capitalists. But just surely that, just from a standpoint of just basic logic, they're not going to risk lawsuits for planes crashing and killing people because they forewent certain standards and this and that. Yeah, they will. We know they will. These things have been documented. And the reason why is because there's lawsuits on both sides of the equation. On one side, it's lawsuits for malpractice, that you broke certain standards of qualifications and a meritocracy.
Yeah, but Joe is...
But on the other side, there's the lawsuits of perceived racism, that, you know, you got too many white people employed here and you haven't got offered enough opportunities for minorities.
But Joe,
minorities.
Who didn't put the door on right on the Boeing plane? We don't know. My point is, there's other ways to go about finding out if a person is credible, if a person is qualified. But if the first thing you look at, because listen, Black folks, we've been dealing with this all our lives. For the longest, we've had to get past, hey, this is a Black doctor. Hey, this is a Black so-and-so. Give me the white one. Give me the white doctor. Give me the white dentist. I've been trying to find the right eyeglass specialist or optometrist. And the last one I went to who was touted, this white lady, horrible. The best doctor I've ever had in my life was a Black man. He obviously knew stuff, but he explained everything.
Praise God.
He told he said, this is what I want you to understand, so that when someone tells you something that you can kind of understand, you can help us. The best doctor I've ever had was Black. Now, when I look at a doctor, my assumption is he's qualified. He, she, her, whatever. Because if that's the case, then truth be told, I don't even want the white guy. Give me the Pakistani, give me the Indian. But what I really assume is a person is qualified, and then thereafter I'll make my assumption. But when you make the statement, Joe, you got to at least know that people are going to look at that. And even if you had some truth to what you're saying, how you said it, because you chose the analogy, everything that you said is now disqualified. And so now am I no longer looking at what you said about Christian nationalism. I now look at you as not a Christian. I now look at you as a racist white man who only wants to advocate for white folks, white Anglo-Saxon, Anglo people. That may not be the case, but that's how you put it. And so when someone, and you're right.
That's not how I put it.
Well,
that's how someone can interpret it. Sure. But that's not how I put it.
But if okay, Joel, do you think that you're giving them admonition to interpret these things this way?
I think I'm having conversations that everybody is thinking about and that somebody needs to have the balls to say.
But why would you say it that way? Why would you say that between the African man? Why not say between the white guy and the Pakistani? Why not between the woman and the man?
Sure. That wasn't the, but I was using, in that case, like I said, I was actually using a real life example, and it didn't happen to be a Pakistani. To use another one of my racist examples, in my neighborhood, I didn't use Black people. In my neighborhood, I used Hindus, you know,
I think I saw somewhere else in another clip, and granted, these folks are going to, who disagree with you, are going to go and find clips. I think I went once to your channel. Everywhere else I got from different clips, because it's just easier to find. I get that.
Oh, of course.
And so when someone clips out something about me, well, they got to go to the scripture. They literally have to go to the scripture. Corey said this. All right, let's talk about this. No, you're wrong. You can't read. That's fine. But if I'm giving an argument that can't be quantified by, you know, something in black and white, I'm making an assumption. I think you made a statement about neighbors and whites and so forth or whatever. I can't remember how it was. I saw the clip, but I didn't save the clip. I think what you really want are people that are going to love this country and work hard for this country and fight for this country, irrespective of their color. So say that rather than putting, if because you got to be wise enough to say or know that if someone hears me put black, white, Hindu, this or that on there, well, then all of your arguments have to get past that racial or that component, that firewall that you just put up. They got to get past that to understand what you're saying. So if there's truth to what you're saying, say it. You've got to say it better, because the argument that people are throwing at you that you might be racist or racial or race-ish, that's a making of your own doing. I want to play this next clip, because this is why, and I was like, wow, I cannot, you should have gotten, and I know he's probably a friend of yours, but me And maybe I'm not getting the right understanding, so maybe you can help me. But on hearing this,
real quick, before you play, I'll make it super fast. But the last thing I was going to say about the doctor thing is, one, I do really think that we can question even in the field of medicine. I really believe this. I really do think that over the last, 15 years, and it's been longer, but especially the last 15 years, and especially the last 4 years of all the craziness and insanity about DEI, diversity hires, equity, inclusion, and these kinds of, and wokeness and blah, blah, blah. I really do think that it's fair to have some real questions. It does not make you racist. I think it's legitimate and fair to have some real questions about qualifications in virtually every field imaginable. And I do not believe that hospitals and that the realm of medicine is an exception. And then secondly, and lastly, beyond that, my thinking and my point was not even just to say, number one, I was not saying, I bet you this individual black cardiologist is not qualified. That's certainly not what I was saying. But what I was saying is, at a statistical level, all things being equal, at a statistical level, in our current culture, culturally, politically, racially, at every level, right now, if there's going to be a preference given, it's going to be given to minorities, not to white people. Jeremy, I'm blanking on his last name, but he just wrote a book, Anti-White Discrimination, and it's really helped. And he documents through there all the DEI practices and all the right now, it's not the 1950s. If it was, then this wouldn't apply. But in 2024, if anything, on the books, there's discrimination against white people in our nation. And then the last thing I was going to say is, even if I'm wrong, and every cardiologist in the United States of America really is objectively qualified, that they all met objective qualifications, you still can't have two cardiologists. You need one. So then the question becomes, it's just like pastors or elders, right? It goes to, like I always use this example, the Bible gives qualifications for elders. There's a minimum bottom, a minimum bar must be this tall to ride the ride. That doesn't mean that every objectively qualified elder is equal. You could be an older, wiser, more mature, more better preacher, more gifted elder. It means you've got to be at least this qualified. This is the minimum qualifications, but you could be above that. You could be even better. Same with any other field, including the field of medicine. So let's just say that DEI has not affected the medical field or in the particular realm of cardiology to the level that you actually have people who are getting in who are objectively unqualified. Let's say everybody is qualified. Is it still possible? Is it possible that DEI could have affected that field to the level to where everyone's meeting the minimum bar of qualifications, but if there's 100 qualified people, all are qualified at the minimum objective level, but only 80 job openings, that the 80 job openings wouldn't be the guys who are qualified and then above and beyond, but it would be in that 80, hey, we need to meet a quota of different skin colors outside of white and outside, for that matter, also outside of Asian. And I think that that's possible. And again, you don't have two cardiologists. You're going to have one. It is a defensible position. I understand that it upset people.
But how come you didn't just normally go to, if you've got only so many positions to give, how come Biff from Georgetown didn't get the job at UT Medical because his father was a doctor also there on staff at UT Medical? Why didn't that come into play? My point is, there's all sorts of reasons. I mean, there's been a lot of reasons why folks who are unqualified, who are white, have made it in. And so
that's true.
What I'm saying is you, Joel, are negating yourself from getting the benefit of the doubt if you constantly use things that where you don't have to necessarily use race. So if someone if people have a view, this is something that I've been told a long time ago. If people view you a certain way, don't look at them, look at you, because something that you're doing, something you're saying, some places you're frequenting, that's causing them to view you that way. And if that's the case, then you have to rehabilitate that if you think that you have an actual good message. Because there's some things that you've stated or things that I felt like, doggone it, Joel, that's problematic. Let me play this last clip. This bothered me. Again, I could be wrong. So you're going to have to clean this up and tell me why I shouldn't, or no one else should be bothered by this isn't you. but you're there, why we shouldn't be bothered by this clip.
The deeper meaning of life, the sort of things that the heart owns, such as ethnic identity, cultural particularity, or a strong connection of people and place, must be supplied or rooted outside of America. Thus, the true Americans in New America are the hyphenated Americans. In a sense, these people are more complete human beings than the unhyphenated. Why? Because they have settled hearts with a people and a place, albeit a foreign place, while the unhyphenated have no place of their own. But we, the unhyphenated, those who trace our ancestry to Western Europe, whose roots extend beyond the Immigration Act of 1965 and Ellis Island, and which unite to this soil, we, the white Anglo-Saxon Protestants who founded, built, and died for and led this country for most of its history, we are not permitted in this new America to have a people or a place that is distinctly ours. There's no distant place that we call home. We have nowhere else to go. But this is our home. This is our native land. We are Native Americans, born of those who didn't immigrate, but who settled here. We are the sons and daughters of the people who settled this land. To describe America as a nation of immigrants, writes the great Harvard political scientist Samuel Huntington, is to stretch a partial truth into a misleading falsehood and to ignore the central fact of America's beginning as a society of settlers. Yet the country that our ancestors built is no longer for us, for those whose hearts are settled here like us. It is not for those whose people are old stock Americans.
So it comes across of what he's saying. And I was honestly, I was so bothered by what he was saying. Now, it could be that I'm just not catching it. I'm not getting it. But to say, and I hate when people say this. I hate when folks say that immigrants that came to this country in the last 20, 30 years built this country. No, you didn't. Or especially when someone says it's the white folks that, or when he, what he's saying, that they built the country. Not by yourself, you didn't. There's a whole lot of folks who also built this country. This country was built off of, by, for, to the benefit for, also against a whole lot of people. This country is what it is, whether it be a righteous start or an unrighteous start, what have you. It is what it is, and there are a lot of folks that contribute. When he makes the statement that we, the unhyphenated people, well, first of all, this hyphenation that we have, African American, Black American, Hispanic American, whatever, who gave us that? White folks did. So he's really railing against the very system that white folks started. Black folks didn't give up. We didn't come up with the term African American. White folks did that.
Jews did that. But go ahead.
Okay, no. White liberals did that. White liberals. Now, were some of them Jews? Sure.
African American was not, that was not just a bunch of guys, you know, who came over from England in the 1600s. That was, and I'm not talking about, you know, I'm not going to be unhinged here and be crazy about some huge Jewish cabal, but that is something that I have studied and spent some time reading. And that idea was very much coined from Jews in America.
All of the hyphenated peoples, Jews gave up all of those?
I'm just saying the African American one. That one was.
What about XYZ American? And so the people that all we know is this. It was someone that looked like you that had that sort of cultural background, as far as we know, that did that. It wasn't blacks or other folks that say, okay, you're this group, you're that group, or whatever. And so everything that he's railing against, he's really railing against himself, but it's for the benefit and uplifting for himself. To me, it was just one of those things, okay, if I'm standing in a place like that and I hear that, I myself am excusing myself, walking out, and then thereafter that having a video, a conference, or something about what was just said. That to me was repulsive. Now, I could be wrong. I may have just misunderstood his point. So, what point was he making that I'm not catching?
Well, he goes on. If you listen to the entirety of the talk, at the end of the talk, he says, "Okay, so now you know." His talk was it was titled "Against Multiculturalism." Against multiculturalism. Not against whatever. It's not against multiple ethnicities. It's against multiculturalism. That was the title of his talk. He was saying that part of the reason America is failing is because America has not really been operating as a nation for quite some time. We have much more similarities historically and with certain components that are indicative of an empire much more than a distinct nation. And, you know, kind of like almost like the Roman Empire and just taking in provinces underneath your massive expanse, you know, under the shadow of your wings, you know. And so then you have, you know, this and that. And that's part of the, you know, the fall of Rome was that it stretched itself too thin And it lost a cohesive bond. You no longer really had people in place in this commonality of your fellow kinsmen, your fellow, you know, national citizens. And it was all these factions. And it's just like, well, really, my allegiances lie with, you know, the Irish and lie with the Scottish and lie with this and lie with, and not so much with Rome, but I'm mixing metaphors here. But the point is, that was Stephen Wolfe's talk. It was against multiculturalism. So then he advocates and says, so we don't need a bunch of different cultures, culture coming from the Latin word cultus, which means worship. We don't need polytheism. We don't need the worship of many gods and many cultures. And we need a monoculture. Now, there will be subsets of culture within, like we talked about earlier, Indiana versus Texas and those kinds of things. And that's rich in our tradition and our heritage and our history. And I don't think that any of that is a problem. But we do need one overarching monoculture, one culture, not monoethnic, but monoculture. And then he went on to espouse what he believes that culture is historically and what he thinks is also proper biblically. And he said that in America's case, that culture is Anglo-Protestant. It's an Anglo-Protestant. And then he went on at the end of his talk, if you watch the end of it, and this is where it was funny, you know, because guys, you know, there were some guys in the crowd, and it wasn't just like, you know, like all the people who are ethnic minorities. There were white guys in the crowd who are like, you know, they're cringing a little bit, just like you are, Corey, you know, and they're watching this and like, oh man, sounding a little racist. And, you know, and he gets to the end of his talk and he says, now let me list for you a few of my favorite Anglo-Protestants that are a part of this great monoculture of America that we should have and that we once did have. And he says, you know, some of them are Thomas Sowell, Clarence Thomas, Vody Bachum. I think you see my point, Corey. Stephen Wolfe, much to many people's chagrin, a lot of people really, I mean, they're working hard to make him a racist, mm-hmm. but he's not.
So something my father said to me, now this is him being harsh to me, but I got the point. If you don't want people to think you're stupid, don't act like it. If you don't want people to think you're racist, don't act like it. Don't say things that go that way, that look that way. Don't even make fun. Don't even, because if we're going to be, you're a pastor. So you have to have more wisdom than the average person. Because why? You are leading a flock of people yep. who look to you. Because however you, if you flinch, your audience, they'll fall. If you That's move right. an inch to the left, they'll move a mile to the left. That's kind of right. how it works. And so it has to be clear. We got one job. Got it. And it's the problem with us in the church. We can talk about things political. I do too. But I do it from the standpoint of how Christians ought to behave, not mandating other people. Because if Christians acted like Christians, you want folks to think you're a Christian? Act like it. If you're going to vote like a Christian would. If you're going to spend your money like a Christian would. Let the fact that you're a believer stand out. That way you don't have to worry about how bad the America is, because you would have people in office that actually held your values. If the 68% of Americans who claim to be Christians, which they're not, actually were, or at least those that went to church, the church goers in America that support these 300,000 churches, if they actually acted like Christians, if the pastors were doing their job, and let's be honest, most of them don't, that ought to be our focus. Because again, we got one job, and that is to proclaim the gospel and to cause folks to rally around him. We preach one kingdom. We preach one government, not an American government, although I would love to see our government act more like it claimed to be. But we could fix that if Christians acted like the way Christians would, even non-Christians. Jesus's words are true. Let your light, Corey Minor, Joel Webbin, or anyone else's, let your light so shine. Let folks see you, not your talking, not what you hope for, not what you wish for, not either inflammatory words or even words that are selectively chosen that are wise. Let people see your works. And then they'll glorify God. They're not going to do it because you want a Christian nation. They're not going to do it because you got the biggest church or because you said something on CNN or MSNBC or Fox, what have you. Nope. If they see you loving that Hindu in that Hindu garb, if they see you loving that black person, that white person, that woman, that child, whomever, if they see that, I can promise you, you'll get more, you'll get a closer Christian community than you ever would. That's got to be the focus.